Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you share it with a friend. This morning, Pastor John continues a series entitled, Can I Trust God? The call to go to the land of Canaan came to Terah first, but he failed to fulfill God's command. Abraham was 75 years old when God told him the same thing. God made such a strong impression on Abraham that he immediately sought a city whose builder and maker was none other than Jesus. Abraham was very prosperous, but he also encountered problems that tested his faith. More than two decades later, it got to the point that Abraham no longer believed Jesus and openly laughed at him. Abraham had a written account of creation. He knew about the fall of mankind and life before the flood, but, and this is a big one, he did not know if God was supreme. How much control did God exercise over earthly affairs? This message is entitled, Wavering Faith. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord, and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church worldwide. And this is a live webcast today that you're having. And I'm going to be talking to you today about wavering faith. And this is a series called, Can I Trust God? Can you trust God? Is God there when you need it? If you have your Bibles, we're going to start in Genesis 31:19. And let me just share with you here from what we have from the outline. We're going to talk about Abraham's early years. Now, Terah named his firstborn son Abram, which means God is exalted. Now, he was born in the city of Ur, which is in southern Iraq. He was the 10th generation from Noah. And he lived with the descendants of Shem, who had turned into the Chaldean people group. 10 generations. And the people at that time have forgotten the flood. They've forgotten the judgment of God. They've forgotten about Noah, his three sons. And it would be like if I would take you back to the early days in the United States when the first pilgrims came here and others came here in the 1600s. And you would have no personal knowledge of that. You would not know how they lived, how they ate, how they were clothed, and things like this, unless we have written documentation called history. So most of the people at that time did not have it, and they didn't care. I can go back in my family line. I can go back to 1850, and I can go back to my great-great-grandparents, and I know who they were, where they lived, and what they did. As we've done deliverances for years, and we asked people, we said, now, what do you know about your grandparents? Well, they lived over here someplace, and we never met them, we don't know. What about their great-grandparents? Who knows? Most people today basically knows their parents. Maybe their grandparents, but not any further than that. And people today, young people, they're not interested in to find out what their ancestors were, what they did, what kind of heritage they have. They live for today. Now, the Bible doesn't say about the language at this time, But when we read the Bible, we find out that Abram had no problem talking to the Egyptians. He had no problem talking to the people living in the land of Canaan. So the language must have been the same in that area at that particular time. According to the Jewish Midrash, that's part of the Talmud, they're simply saying this, that Terah had a factory. He was producing idols, little things of stolen wood, selling them, and he must have done good because he was rich. Let's read from Genesis 31, verse number 19. And we read the following. And Laban went to shear his sheep, and Rachel had stolen the images that were her father's. Now Laban was related. We have Terah, who had Nahor, who had Laban, third generation. This guy had house gods. And when we had Rachel here, stole them when they left, Laban got bent out of shape. And he took his armed men, they overtook Jacob, and Laban was ready to kill Jacob over a house god. Where are they? Someone stole my house gods. I can't function without these house gods. But praise God, our God is in heaven. No one can steal him. But anyway, that's what they had. So most likely, we had that Abraham, or Abram as it was called, was probably not that strong in faith. It is just like today in America. We have a lot of idolatry. Every Halloween, the Christians celebrate, they call it harvest party. Come Christmas, we got the tree, we got the holly, we got all kind of different things. And we have all the idolatry that came from paganism. We just called it Christians. Come Easter, you know, we have our Easter egg hunts. I don't know what the Easter egg hunts have to do with the resurrection of Jesus. But if it is a Pentecostal church or Baptist church, God help the pastor if he doesn't organize an Easter egg hunt. They will hang him. So we're pretty much like Terah and Abraham. We have knowledge of God. Some of us are born again. We read the Bible, but we have our house gods. And then we wonder, why do we not have more power? Let's turn to Genesis 11 now. That Genesis chapter 11. And here's an interesting thing. God called Terah to go to the land of Canaan. And I'll pick it up in verse 24. And Nahor lived after begat Terah 119 years, and begat sons and daughters. And Terah lived 70 years, and begat Abram, Nahor, and Haran. Now these are the generation of Terah. Terah begat Abram, Nahor, and Haran, and Haran begat Lot. And Haran died before his father Terah, the land of his nativity, in Ur of the Chaldees. And Abraham and Nahor took them wives. The name of Abram's wife was Sarai. The name of Nahor's wife, Milcah, the daughter of Haran, the father of Milcah, and the father of Iscath. But Sarah was barren. She had no child. And Terah took Abram, his son, Lot, the son of Haran, his son's son, and Sarah, his daughter-in-law, the son of Abram's wife, and they went forth with them from Ur of the Chaldees to go into the land of Canaan. And they came unto Haran and dwelt there. And the days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. I think it's interesting for you and me today when we look upon this, because very few preachers have pulled this out. They simply don't think about it. They don't want to talk about it. But Abraham was not the first one to be called. His dad, Terah, was told, get out of Ur and go to the land of Canaan. And he did uproot. They were rich people. They had camels, sheep, oxen, servants. There were probably several thousand people. And they uprooted out of Ur. They came up to Haran, which at that time was a very prosperous trading city. And apparently, Terah was a good businessman. And he decided, forget the calling of God, forget going to Canaan. This is a good city. I can make good money here. And he stayed there. And he died there. Now, I want you to think this with me. Today, the Bible talks about it. Jesus talked about it. We have the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It could have been the God of Terah, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But Terah blew it. He made lots of money. Lived probably a good life. Ate well every day. But as far as eternity is concerned, I think he's kicking himself right now and saying, how stupid was I? I could have been in this line of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And I blew it because I got greedy. And many people are called by God to do certain things. It's not necessarily you're called to be a pastor, an evangelist, but you're called to be Bible teacher, teaching Sunday school, witness, be a giver, do this or that. But we are too busy working to make more money. Here's a thought you should have. You should not try to make money so you can make more money. You should try to make money so you can make a living and you can serve the Lord. We should eat to live, not live to eat. A lot of people are living so they can eat and get more. Let's talk about the calling of Abraham now. Chapter 12, if you pick it up here in the first three verses. Now the Lord has said unto Abraham, get you out of your country, from your kindred, from your father's house, unto a land I will show you. And I will make of you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless you, and curse him that curseth you. And in you shall all families of the earth be blessed. So Abram departed, as the Lord had spoken to him, and Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. Here's Abram now. He knew he would probably live to about 150 years old, so they were used to that. Being 75 years old, he had developed his own business. He was in the cattle industry. He had lots of camels, cattle, sheep. It is estimated he had about 1,000 people working for him. We know that because he had 300 trained men that were soldiers that he had with him. They had wives. They were children. And so Abraham now looked upon in Haran, and he looked to go toward Canaan. It was a risk. There were city kings. There were robbers. He could have been overtaken by someone greater than what his 1,000 people. He could have lost it all. But it's one thing we got to hand to Abraham. He heard God. He believed God. And he simply said, we're going. Notice now in the scripture here, it doesn't say that Abraham asked Sarai, would you like to go to the land of Canaan? He didn't ask her. He simply said, Sarah, we are going. When you hear from God, when God speaks to you, God doesn't break up marriages. But when God speaks to you, you don't compromise. You don't say, well, God spoke to me, and your spouse says, well, I'm not too sure about that. Why don't you cool it? If you hear from God, you don't cool it. You do it. Or God will simply say, fine. He pushed you on the side, and you get stuck in a river with the bushes, and he simply said, sit on the parking lot. See you later. I'll call somebody else. If you don't obey, God will simply say, fine. Go your way and call somebody else. Let's look at Hebrews 11:8. You know, it is easy, you know, if you really never have broken up and leave someplace and do some things, but it takes faith. In Hebrews 11, and we begin here in verse number 8. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go into a place which he should after receive an inheritance, obeyed. And he went out, not knowing whither he went. By faith, he sojourned in the land of promise, as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked for a city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Are you looking for that same city, the city of God? I remember, and I'll be very short on this, at the age of about 6 years old, watching American airmen who had been shot down and were confined to Sweden march with a marching band, coffins on wagons, horse-drawn wagons, as they were going to the cemetery for service for those that had been shot down and killed in the raids of Germany. I remember standing there with my mom and dad, and I heard a voice. These are your people. You don't belong here. Someday, you're going to go to where you belong. I explained that to my parents. They simply blew it off. It never left me. I did a lot of detours. But when I got about 19 years old, the calling came back. I had to go to America. And I began to set my mind on that. I met my wife, Aina. And we only been together maybe once or twice. I said, look, when I graduate from college, I'm going to the United States. If you want to marry me, that's what you're going to do. She told me later, she said she blew it off and said, well, he got 2.5 years left of college. By that time, he'll forget it. When the time came, I went to college and we left. I had with me $300, four suitcases. I ended up with my uncle in Salt Lake City, the Mormon. He sponsored us. And 6 weeks after, we got kicked out because we didn't join a Mormon church. And I ended up in the poorest part of town in Salt Lake City, living in an apartment with no air conditioning, hot as hell. That's how I got here. I never thought about going back. This is where I made my commitment to Christ. I recommitted myself in 65. This is where God called me to preach in 67. And I'm glad that I heard God and I left, because we have lived a fabulous life. And I can look back now and saying, I'm glad I put the time in to lead people to Christ, to pray for the sick, to do funerals, weddings, and all the things that we've done in the ministry, and still do. If you have a calling upon God upon you, and you have, everyone got a calling to do something, obey him. Let's turn to Genesis 12:7 now. Genesis 12:7. Now, God knew that Abraham's faith was wavering. And he appeared to him again, and this is Jesus appearing to him. And the Lord appeared unto Abram and said, unto your seed will I give this land. And there built he an altar unto the Lord who appeared unto him. God will confirm in your life. You will not have a certain point when you know God spoke to you. And then there will be more time for God will speak to you. Most of the time, God speaks through the Bible. You read the Bible and he speaks to you. It can be somebody called you up. You meet somebody, the divine appointment. And you meet the person. And that person has a message for you from the Lord. God will confirm for you and with you as you continue. Let's turn now to Genesis 12, and I'm going to turn now to verses 10 through 20. Remember this now. When you got a good job, you had a nice place to live, you are healthy, you got money in the bank, nice vehicle to drive, life is good. Your faith can never be tested there. Good times does not test the faith. Faith is tested in bad times. And that's why from time to time, God will take away some of your goodies to simply say, let's have a test. In verse 10, we read this. And there was a famine in the land, and Abram went down unto Egypt to sojourn there, for the famine was grievous in the land. And it came to pass, when he was come near to enter into Egypt, that he said to Sarah, his wife, behold now, I know that you are a fair woman to look upon. And she was a nice-looking woman. Therefore, it shall come to pass, When Egyptians see you, they shall say, this is his wife, and they will kill me, but they will save you alive. So I pray you, you are my sister, that it may be well with me for your sake, and my soul shall live because of you. Now, Abraham had a lying spirit. And today, a lot of people have lying spirits. Matter of fact, most people lie every day. Somebody asks you, how are you doing today? You might not be doing too well. What do you say? I'm okay. I'm fine. You ask other people, and they say, I'm fine. You know, I really don't want to know how you're doing. It's just a phrase, how you're doing. It's meaningless. Because if you really want to know, the person who says, well, I really got some problems, and you said, I don't have time to hear that now. I just meant to say hello. So let's be honest. You know, you meet buddy, a good friend, lady friend, and she, you know, has just bought a brand new dress, and she looks nice. She thinks she looks nice. And you see that dress, and she says, how do you like my new dress? And you think, oh, my God. So what do? You say, oh, it's that beautiful dress. You're lying. You should say, well, it's not my taste. Or you've been to somebody and you served a meal and the food was awful and you tell her, oh, this is a great meal. You're lying. God is light. In him is no darkness. You walk in the light. You do not lie. So Abraham, how much did he trust God? Zero. That's how much his faith was. Now, the rest of the story here, of course, Pharaoh saw her. Verse 15, the princes also of Pharaoh saw her, commanded her before Pharaoh, and the woman was taken to Pharaoh's house. And he entreated Abraham well for her sake. He had sheep and oxen, and he asses, and men servant and maid servant, and she asses and camels, that's male and female. And the Lord plagued Pharaoh in his house with great plagues because of Sarai, Abraham's wife. And Pharaoh called Abraham and said, what is this that you have done unto me? Why did you not tell me that she was your wife? Why? Fear. Why said you, she's my sister, so I might have taken her to be to wife. Now therefore, behold your wife, take her and go your way. Get lost. And Pharaoh commanded his men concerning him, they sent him away, and his wife and all that he had. Can you see Abraham there? His head hanging like this. He's been a confirmed liar. No faith. He's going back now to the land of Canaan. Well, God is testing us. When you fail, repent. Start over again. Then we had another confirmation from the Lord. Chapter 15. There's chapter 15. And we pick it up here, a few verses. I'm not going to read all of them. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, fear not, Abram. I am your shield, your exceeding great reward. And Abram said, Lord God, what would you give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house of this Eliezer of Damascus? And Abraham said, behold, to me you have given no seed, and lo, one born in my house in my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, this shall not be your heir, but he that shall come forth out of your own bowels shall be your heir. And he brought it forth abroad and said, look now toward heaven, tell the stars if you be able to number them. And he said unto him, so shall your seed be. And at this point, Abraham believed in the Lord, and he counted for him for righteousness. So now he had faith. I see the stars. I believe God. I believe that this is going to happen. And then later in that chapter, he does a sacrifice. Now let's turn to chapter 16. Some 10 years has passed, and this is what is important. You have a hard time to stay the course. We get excited. Praise God, I'm going to do this today. Man, we're going to do this or that. 6 months later, I meet you and said, how's it going? Oh, well, you know, it didn't work out. I mean, no, blah, 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 blah. Lost it. People don't have stamina. You stay with it. You don't change. I tell people this when I'm in counseling. Had this couple this week, and I was talking about the commandments of God. I said, okay, now let's have a little discussion here. I said to the wife, if your husband comes home tomorrow and say, you know, I just found my old girlfriend on Facebook. And we talked. And she wants us to get together, have a dinner. We're not going to have any sex, just have a dinner. What do you think? And the woman said, absolutely not. I said to the woman, now, if the husband would do the same thing, he would want to see his old girlfriend. Good old times. No. I said, now, this is amazing. You are humans. When you got married, you made a vow. I'm going to stay faithful to my husband. I'm going to stay faithful to my wife. And I'm not going to cheat. How can you do that? Well, we love each other. Yeah. I said, that's wonderful. Now, Christ is the groom. We are the bride. Why can't you stay faithful to him? Ah, that's a different story. It's amazing. Anyway, let's get into chapter 16 here now. Now Sarai, Abram's wife, bare him no children. She had a handmaid, an Egyptian, whose name was Hagar. And Sarah said to Abraham, behold now, the Lord has restrained me from bearing. I pray you, go into my maid. It may be that I might obtain children by her. And Abram hearkened to the voice of Sarai. Now, think about this. Your wife says, hey, I want to go have sex with this woman over here. Abraham now had got the word from God. He looked at the stars. He said, I believe. 10 years later or so, we still haven't gotten any children. And Abraham now, his faith, zero. That's how you and I go. Up and down and up and down. So, he says, fine. I go in, had sex, he got pregnant, they got Ishmael, and it didn't take long. There was no harmony. Verse 5, and Sarah said to Abram, my wrong be upon you. I've given my maid into your bosom. When she saw that she had conceived, I was despised in her eyes. The Lord judged between me and you. Sarai had power over Abraham. He was a pushover. He was a milk toast. First, he was told, we don't have sex. Okay? They got a child. Now Sarah says, I'm not happy. Instead of Abraham saying, woman, shut up. You have me do this? Live with it. Be decent. Be kind. Because instead he said this. But Abraham said to Sarah, behold, your maid is in your hand. Do to her as it pleases you. And when Sarah dealt hardly with her, she fled from her face. Abraham was no different than you and I. He failed again. Grief and sorrow came. Let's turn up to chapter 17. And we read here from verse number 1. And when Abraham was 99, the Lord appeared to Abraham and said to him, I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be you perfect. And I will make my covenant between me and you and will multiply you exceedingly. God said, now, Abraham, I'm going to fulfill what I told you I would do. Now, Abraham was 99. Sarah was 89. And according to childbearing, you don't have an 89-year-old lady have sex and getting pregnant. That doesn't happen. So, we read on here in this chapter here, and then I will be picking up in verse number 15. And God said to Abraham, as for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her name Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. And that means a princess, also mother of nations. And I will bless her and give your son also of her. Yea, I will bless her, and she shall be a mother of nations. King of people shall be of her. Then Abraham fell down. He was laughing so hard. How can you see him go rolling on the floor or ground? Then Abraham fell upon his face and laughed and said in his heart, shall a child be born unto him that is 100 years old? And shall Sarah that is 90 years old bear? And Abraham said unto God, oh, that Ishmael might live before you. He said, let's have Ishmael. Here's what I want you to get out of this. When you come to a mountain, and you say, this mountain cannot be removed. That's when you have faith in God and say, this mountain is going to be removed. I've had 3 church blow-ups. Have 3 churches fail and blow up. Every time we lost everything. And I had to start all over again. God's been with us. We never missed a beat. We continue. This is what God needs in these days. You put your hand on the plow. You don't take your hand off. You don't look back. You simply said, God said it. I believe it. I'm doing it. That's it. You don't look upon circumstances. Now, after this, God had told him to have everybody circumcised. This had not been done before, and I'm sure that somebody circumcised Abraham. He didn't do it himself. And they probably were sick for a few days after that. But I want to turn right now to, we've been in 17, and I want to go right now to Romans 9, 4 through 8. That's Romans chapter 9 and verses 4 through 8. Who are Israelites, to whom pertaining the adoption of the glory and the covenant and the giving of the law and the service of God and the promises? Whose are the fathers, and of whom are concerned in the flesh? Christ came. Who is over all? God blessed forever. Amen. Now, as through the word of God are taken on effect, for they are not all Israel, which are of Israel, neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children, but in Isaac shall your seed be called. That is, they which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted for the seed. For this is the word of promise. At this time will I come, and Sarah shall have a son. The apostles made a declaration. There is no name given under heaven whereby men can be saved, that is Jesus Christ. Today a Jew, because he's a Jew, does not make him saved. Jews, Gentiles, Greeks, barbarians, we all have one thing in common. We have to be saved through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and repenting from our sins. That's the only way to get in. So the covenant now is with and through Christ. I want to turn to page 3 of my outline now. And I want to come down to the summary. And we're going to be talking about this next week, that they did get a son. Now, we've got to hand this to Abraham and Sarah. I want you to see this 99-year-old man, 90-year-old woman. And they said, okay, we're going to do our part. They did have sex on a regular basis. And God used that. And she got pregnant. Let me slow down. When God wants you to do something, and he promised you, I will do this, but he always wants us to be part of it. You do the possible, and God will do the impossible. In this ministry, God will do the miracles, but we have to apply ourselves. I have to write sermons, newsletters, talk to people. My staff here, they are working, talking to people, doing deliverances. We have to put our 5 cents in. And then God moves in with the Holy Spirit. So remember this. When God calls you, you step out in faith. And then God will do the rest. Let me read this summary here to you. When Abraham blessed his father Haran at the age of 75, he took the written account of creation, Adam and Eve, their fall into sin, life up to the flood through the books of Enoch. Noah also wrote his life story, and each subsequent patriarch recorded their firstborn son. That's the stuff that Abraham had. Abraham preserved that to Isaac, Isaac to Jacob. Jacob preserved to his sons. And 430 years later, these records were given to Moses, that then wrote them down and made it to Genesis chapter 1. Actually, Genesis, the book of Genesis. And then, of course, Moses wrote some of the other books, and then Joshua finished what Moses started. At the same time, Abraham was not sure whether God was supreme. I don't know where you are. We are facing right now COVID-19. The question is, do I have to be scared? What should I do? I think we should be cautious. We should do what we can. But I believe that God can supernaturally protect us from this virus. That's how I live. I get out during the week. I do shopping. I do other things. And I don't walk out and say, oh, my God, I hope I make it today. I hope I don't meet anyone. I have no fear. I don't think about it. I simply told my people this. If the virus comes and lands here, it's going to die. It's trespassing. I am God's property. The Holy Ghost is within me. I don't have to succumb to it. Abraham was not sure at this time that God was supreme. He knew he was a powerful God, but how powerful was he? Most of you believe that God is powerful, but you really don't believe he is that powerful. And that's why we have doubt and unbelief. And that's why you don't move the way God wants you to move. It will take several more events and years and appearance from Jesus before Abraham had full faith in God. I've been in the ministry now 58 years, I believe. Now, when I started, I had a lot of faith. And I was looking down, I'm writing my biography, going over that. And I realized we had a lot of healings, a lot of demons cast out. We lived in the supernatural. And I realized that I had a childish faith at that time. But now I've been around too many people that are belonging to what I call the bucket brigade. Let me explain what a bucket brigade is. In the old days, in the United States, when there was a fire, they didn't have any fire engines. They got everybody lined up. Each one got a bucket. They had one guy standing over here filling a bucket from the lake or whatever, and it was passed on, and then the last guy would throw it on the fire. That's called a bucket brigade. There's a lot of bucket brigade people, and over the years, they've thrown a lot of water up there. Unbelief, can't do that, can't do that, that doesn't work. All kind of things. Today, my faith is strong. I understand that God is supreme, no problem there. But there have been too many disappointments. Too many disappointments. And you get disappointed. And it eats on your faith. So what I'd like you to do today is to simply say this. I might have had a lot of disappointments. A lot of people had let me down. But God, help me. Give me new faith, a new vision. We're going to close in Romans 10:17. As Romans chapter 10, verse number 17. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Notice now, you can pray and pray and pray for faith. You're not going to get it there. You have a regular habit of reading the Bible on a regular basis. That is how faith is going to build. Faith comes by the word. When we have faith, we pray. You don't pray to get faith. You read the Bible to get faith. Then you thank God that He's given you faith. So what do I want you to take home with you today? Well, you got two sermons here today. You got one that was maybe a little bit negative to begin with. And then we talked about Abram and Sarah. I want you to think about when you leave the service this afternoon, where you at? Where did you come from? This is where you are now. What are your plans for tomorrow? What are your plans for tomorrow? Ask God, forgive me for not having been doing everything I should. Let me start over. Some of you are doing good. Ask God to bless you more. But ask God this. I want to grow in faith. I want to be like Abraham. He got more revelations and finally was solid. Get me there. When do you eat? Well, some people eat because they like to eat. But most people eat when they are hungry. So my question to you is this. Are you hungry for more of God? Are you hungry to learn more? Are you hungry to learn what to do in the next step in your life? If you're hungry, He's going to feed you. But if you're not hungry, you're going to be a turkey walking around eating stuff on the ground, watching the eagles fly up there and say, I would like to be an eagle, but I'm just a turkey. There are two kinds of Christians. We got the turkeys and we got the eagles. It's a choice. All of us got wings. We got to exercise them and we got to learn how to fly. The choice is yours. Now, you've been listening today, and you're not saved, and you've been saying, you know, I'd like to get into the Christian life. You can. All you have to do is to acknowledge that you are a sinner. Confess that you have sinned, come short of the glory of God. Confess that you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Confess that you believe He died on the cross, rose on the third day. He paid for your sins. Ask God to forgive you. And then say, come on in, Jesus. Come on in, Jesus, in my life and save me. And He will. When we finish here, and the screen changes for you in your home, you will see a screen with three crosses coming up. And you would hear a very soothing voice. My friend. And that's the voice of Pastor Charles Torell. He will take a few minutes and share with you how to get saved, read some scriptures, and have you pray with him so you can know that today you got saved. And in this ministry, we would like to know if you got saved. So write us, call us, so we can rejoice with you. There's a lot more I can say. But this is what I learned in seminary. I learned a few things. I was told this. A sermon is only good as the rear end of the people. When they sit too long, it doesn't matter what you say, They don't hear it. They're gone. So with that, we're going to close. And I'm going to ask you this. Think about what I said. Do an inventory. And then change your life. Let's stand for prayer. Here's Pastor Charles.
Father God, as we looked at the Abram's life here a little bit, and even his father Terah, it says there on that sermon outline, it says it's not how you start, you know, how you your life is with salvation, but how you finish your life. How will you finish? And so, Father God, I'm just kind of reminded of that, you know, we can start off great in a race, and we can be running, but then with the Christian life, we get distracted, we lose focus, we lose interest, things happen. And so, Father God, we ask that you would light a fire, the fire that would just be burning hot, bright, that... And then we would be able to have a desire to kindle that and to not let it go out, but we would nurture it, and we would simply, when the time comes for us to leave here on this earth, that we would not look back and to say, I have regrets about what it is that I didn't do, but that we would be able to say, Father, I did everything that you asked of me. I am ready to go home. So help us, Father God, just to be faithful. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth, and your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are. You've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person. Doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything? Even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7-8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that You would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now, and I put my faith in You. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that You paid for my sins on the cross through Your shed blood, and that You died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank You for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with You. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. You have been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the fifth part in the series, Can I Trust God? And was entitled, Wavering Faith. The call to go to the land of Canaan came to Abraham's father, but he failed to fulfill God's command. Noah was still alive when Jesus called Abraham. God made such a strong impression that Abraham simply went out in faith, not knowing where he went. He was very prosperous, but also encountered problems that tested his faith. Abraham lied to the king of Egypt about his wife. Later, Sarah convinced him to have sex with her slave to produce an heir, and he initiated circumcision with every male in his group. More than two decades later, Abraham still had not received the promised heir and no longer believed Jesus. In fact, he openly laughed at Jesus when he reiterated the promise of a son. Abraham knew about creation, the fall of mankind, and life before the flood, but he did not know if God was supreme. How much control did God exercise over earthly affairs? Jesus was patient, knowing it takes time for faith to develop. It would take several more events and another appearance from Jesus before Abraham had sufficient faith to believe in the impossible. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1753. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.